That's fair. I mean, the ideal for me is walking along the street and seeing someone playing Pokemon Go with their own pair of like Magic Leap, like, and seeing the virtual like Pokemon there, and then being able to interact with them. And it's not like a phone thing. It's like it's much more, because even though Pokemon Go is a multiplayer game, it's not really that multiplayer. You're not seeing the same augmented reality
Can you
experience.
imagine walking around the street and seeing everyone else's augmented reality stuff in your vision as well as your?
So
I
good.
got. Oh, your brain would explode.
It would. We have a question in the chat from Alex asking, how soon do you reckon we'll see a viable AR gaming headset considering the speed of development behind the tech right now?
As I said, I think the first thing we're going to see is a converged, and we already see it. So we know, the Vive Pro has a camera in it that can see outside. I think some of it is being used more to kind of know where you are, location, and stuff like that. But I kind of see something like that coming first, and probably sooner. I in terms of when's the Magic Leap coming out? Have
Well,
they got a release date
so
yet?
they've said summer.
Summer.
Which
Summer of
summer of this year
this year.
for the development kit.
Okay.
So
Is that
that's
Australian summer?
so
Are we
I mean potentially I think some people were saying like, oh, it could be as late as like early September. You're kind of thinking, that's not really summer though, is it,
Okay,
guys?
but we'll give it to them. We'll give it
Yeah.
to them. Okay.
I mean, and that's kind of development kit stuff. So it's gonna be a while before then they start developing stuff that will kind of be relevant for consumers. Like plenty of people bought the Oculus Rift VR headsets when they were still development versions, and those things were early and very
They
rough.
were early, and it took about 3 years from those to get the consumer version. So, if we're looking at that sort of timeline, then we'll expect sort of like 2020, 2021 maybe to see something. But as I said, I think we'll see a VR AR hybrid. It's easy for me to say.
Although then the issue with that is that then you'll have eyes, which are the cameras that are kind of like going to be 2 inches in front of your face,
Potentially.
which I mean potentially like maybe they could do some sort of like post-processing to kind of like give the
Bring it
impression that
close,
they're. But we've already seen how much your brain gets messed up when like the world that it's seeing is not in line with what your brain. So it could potentially. Just got a quick shout out in the stream, a guy called Butcher. Hey man, how's it going? Thank you so much for joining us. Yeah, definitely a couple of years. It's a real chicken and egg problem, isn't it? No one wants to spend a lot of money developing for these headsets whilst there are a few, whilst there are so few out there. And at the same time, no one wants to spend the amount of money that these things cost. And I suppose really what you want is you want a kind of a Nintendo type situation where someone is going, I'm going to build the hardware, I'm going to build some really cool games, and then I'm going to spend the money on the games because I know I'm going to sell a lot of hardware, and they can kind of.
I don't see, Sony or Microsoft with the Xbox kind of going, hey, you know what, we want to bring this into the fold, or I say Nintendo going, hey, let's get the Switch to work with this. I think if they start developing something, then that's when it will accelerate. And we saw that with the PSVR. That's one of the more popular headsets, mainly because it's just kind of cheap and you don't need really expensive hardware to run it as well. So those are the things that will kind of break that barrier to entry for something like that. And that's what we're waiting for. But I think we've got a good few years, Alex.
I agree. I think if kind of VR taught us anything, it's that launching hardware too early, trying to get hardware too cheap, sorry, I think can really harm what people think VR can do. And I think kind of releasing, like, it was great that the PlayStation VR was so cheap. I think not producing dedicated VR controllers, I think repurposing the Move controllers wasn't the best idea.
I think the bigger problem with VR has been the people using Google Cardboard and going, oh, that's VR. I don't need to try the other experience because it's so different.
That's fair. So we're now going to move on to our second topic of the evening, sorry, which is, of course, we had new MacBooks announced last week. We also had the announcement of
Very, very
Microsoft's
quietly. Very,
very,
very
very quietly.
quietly,
They held a small event in New York, and it was really a matter of, there was no on-stage demo at WWDC or their September event. It was really just kind of, hey, here it goes, guys. And then also we had the Microsoft Surface Go, which similarly quite quiet, loads of rumors. Suddenly there was a rumor piece doing the rounds that it was going to be announced today, and then a couple of hours later it appeared. Both of them are kind of trying to do different things. But let's start with the Mac. Sorry, it is the MacBook Pro lineup, not the standard MacBook.
Yeah.
Which I get the impression is a very premium piece of kit.
It's a little bit expensive. I went on the Apple site today and just fully loaded one without the software though, and it came up to £6,200.
Nice.
That's with the i9. To be fair, that's with a 4 terabyte SSD, which adds a lot of cost to it. But you know, even getting a kind of moderately spec one, we are talking about an expensive machine, you know, £2,500, £3,000, which is a fair amount of money. I do wonder if this was kind of pushed forward a little bit by the keyboard issues. The previous MacBook Pro has been kind
so
of
have they,
tarnished with.
Have they solved the keyboard issues?
They have included a rubber membrane, apparently, under the keyboard, which should fix the issue. Good so hope. It was a problem with detritus kind of getting into the keyboard and keys not being able to be pressed properly. Although I have heard people be able to fix it with blowing air into it and things like that, but you don't really want to be doing that, do you?
It's a strange issue, because from what I can see, it is a real issue. Apple have admitted it's a real issue. They've said that if your MacBook is affected by this issue, we'll replace the keyboard free of charge. But then they also have been at pains to kind of say, like, this is a very small amount of MacBooks, not everyone will be affected. So it's at that weird point where I think if it was a big enough problem...
That's because there's a class action lawsuit.
Right,
so they're not going to fully admit that you know, yes, this is a real problem for the whole range, because that becomes a bigger issue for them, really.
That then makes sense. So all of the messaging around the keyboards, they didn't really mention that until people asked them directly about it, and they were just saying, it's quieter, guys, it's quieter, yeah. It's quieter. And then it was only when people kind of went up and said, like, hey, guys, a lot of keyboards have been breaking, does this fix it? And then he kind of said, like, yes, but no, but yes.
That's not what it's for. It's to make it quieter.
It's to make it quieter.
But it fixes that.
But, you know, dust won't get in there for unrelated reasons. I mean, other than that, I get the impression it's pretty much just a spec bump, really. It's got the same touch bars, which means it has Touch ID. They've put in the T2 chip, which will let you summon Siri without having to press a button or anything. But then... I've no idea what your feelings are on Siri. I don't rely on it too much, and I'm an iPhone user.
I don't. I mean, I've reviewed the HomePods, which are, you know, you have to use Siri with, and I find it quite frustrating. It's not there compared to some of the other AI assistants. But you know, a lot of that has to do with Apple's privacy as well. When you kind of balance that, you kind of go, okay, do I want to have my right to privacy and all that side of things, or do I want convenience? I think most people want convenience, to be honest with you.
Yeah, as someone that has a couple of Amazon Echoes around their house constantly listening to them, I'm definitely in the convenience camp.
Yeah, I think one of the most interesting things about the MacBook Pro is if you get the really high-end version with the i9, there's a YouTuber, Dave Lee, who says that the i9 is being throttled because below even stock performance.
Oh, wow, okay.
Because the chassis can't handle the heat that it generates, which is a really, really interesting thing. And it's kind of something that we've seen before, because when Asus kind of built that laptop, remember we had it in the office, they built a laptop, the RX 700, with desktop components in it. It was proper hardcore. They had a massive water cooling dock that you would kind of chunk it. It made sound, like a chunk. And that would kind of overclock it and kind of push it and would make it a very strong, but great gaming PC, essentially. So it's one of those things where you kind of go, you might be better off not going for the top spec version if it's in a product that can't really handle the thermodynamics of that.
I mean, it's always interesting. Like, so I primarily use a desktop PC at home, and there, you know, I've spent like £50 or so on this like massive heat sink thing that sits on top of my CPU, and that's all the cooling I have, and that's like an i7 from like 4 years ago. And then you're thinking like what they pack into a laptop, and they do a good job with that chassis, but you know, if you're gonna spend however extra £100,
it's almost £300-350 for the i9, so it's a lot of extra money.
I think I went through and I spec'd out what I wanted from a MacBook Pro, and so which would be like not too much. Like, I think I wanted a terabyte of storage, 16 gig RAM, like basically like what you'd be looking for in a gaming PC minus the GPU. And my ideal MacBook came out to $3,500. On the gaming topic, we have a question in the chat from Alex, who asks: are these new MacBooks powerful enough to game on?
Yeah, they are. I mean, they've got the 15-inch version has kind of the kind of eGPU, discrete eGPU, the AMD. Oh, I can't remember which one it is now.
Black Magic.
Or I can't remember what it's called, but it is. It will be powerful. I mean, you know, Apple haven't exactly gone to great lengths to make gaming very enticing on Apple. On MacBooks, so yes, absolutely, they're powerful enough to game on, but it depends on the version. I think the 13.5-inch one is only has the Iris graphics.
Oh, okay.
So that might be a bit of an issue.
Keeps it, yeah. I mean, at the other end of the spectrum, though, so you go from the very super premium MacBooks down to the super, well, somewhat affordable.
I've got my question marks about how affordable it is. But yeah.
So what is the Surface Go? Is it a laptop? Is it a tablet? It's been Microsoft. Microsoft have done the Surface lineup for a while.
Yeah. So I mean, if you've seen the Microsoft Surface, it's been out for years. It's a tablet with a little kickstand that can stand up. It comes with a smart little touch cover. Keyboard, actually it doesn't come with that. You have to pay extra for that. That's one of my issues. Mm. And it's actually really nice. It's a really nice productivity tool. It runs Windows, which is great. But, you know, I'd question that how cheap it actually is. I think it's about £409, is that right? For the tablet. That's the base spec model. That's 4 gig of RAM. You know, if you're running Windows, I would say that's not enough.
Yeah.
So you bump that up to the 8 gig one. You should definitely think about doing that if you're thinking of buying it. So when you then fully load it with a keyboard, pen, and Office 365, because you're going to need that, you're looking at £790, which suddenly opens up a lot more potential for getting a laptop at that price as well. You know, there are some seriously good laptops for around that price. And if you don't want the pen, it's still sort of £670. Mm. So it's still a fair amount of money. But my biggest issue with it is that it comes with Windows 10S, right?
Yeah.
And Windows 10S is kind of the light version of Windows. Mm. You can move it up to the kind of full fat version, but you can't go back down.
Right.
The problem with Windows 10S is that you can only use the Microsoft App Store. I mean, have you looked at that?
But there are loads of apps in the Microsoft App Store. You've got Netflix.
And Twitter.
Office.
You've got, there are apps. They're not brilliantly optimized because, again, you know, these guys are going to really work on their apps for iOS and Android because there's so many users of them. But people tend to not use that many of the Windows Store apps. So there's not that many of them. They're not as well optimized as the other ones. So I would say, you know, that's a question mark. Also, the Intel Pentium processor. Maybe a little underpowered.
Intel Pentium Gold?
Gold, yes.
Which sounds like a retirement place for Intel employees.
4415Y, yes, it does. It's like a saga holiday of processors. Yes, I'm a little bit, I don't know. I haven't tested it yet. We haven't got it in. But I do have a question mark about the power of that one.
I mean, I had a quick check of our previous Surface reviews, the ones that we have had in, and like generally, like the Surface laptops are quite nice. They're a little bit pricey for what you get, but they're well built. It's nice hardware.
Yeah.
Not really too many problems there. The Surface, the tablets though, have always frustrated me because it feels like they're not that good as a tablet because they're running Microsoft Windows 10. They're not that good as a laptop because they don't do this. They don't. You can't hold them there and then like have them on your lap. So they're trying to do both and they're not doing either amazingly well.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, when I reviewed the new iPad, I kind of did it with the aim of sort of going, can this replace a laptop? And I kind of went, yeah, it kind of sort of can at £400.
Yeah.
So at £400 or £450 with a keyboard, the laptops at that price range aren't very good. Mm. And I go, you know, for what you want to do, I'd go for that. But a Surface Book is fantastic. Okay, it costs a lot more than a Surface, or the Surface Go, but it's a really, really nice experience, and it's a tablet. You can detach it from the keyboard. Mm. So that's a true hybrid device that is actually really good.
We have one more question here before we're going to move into our wrap-up segment, which is something we kind of have spoken about previously, but I guess Hanif, who's asked this question, came in a little bit later. He's just asking about the throttling issues for the Core i9.
Yeah.
So just quickly, like, what are your thoughts on that?
Okay.
How would it impact your decisions?
So I We haven't tested this yet. Yeah. So this is from another YouTuber. And for me, I would sort of, if it's true, I would opt for the i7, which obviously won't throw out quite as much heat and shouldn't be throttled as much. The other thing is, you can, you know, if you live in Siberia or the North Pole or something like that, then you might be fine with it. You know, it won't be an issue. It'll keep you warm. But I would probably look at downgrading the spec a little bit if that's the case. But it'll be interesting to say if Apple actually bring it, you know, say anything about it as well.
Yeah, I think it'd be really interesting to test that for ourselves. Yeah, you know, put a spec'd out i7 against a spec'd out i9. Work out if that throttling means that you can save yourself a bit of money and go for the i7 with
absolutely.
Any performance tip.
Absolutely.
So that's about all we have time for today. We're just going to move into our final section, which is called One Cool Thing. I'm going to start with myself this week, I think.
Go ahead.
So I finally got my iPhone SE, which I love, back from the repairs. The power button went because it's a year and a half old, and apparently that's long enough for the power button.
Really?
Wow. Yeah, only a year and a half. And I love it. So the moment I got it back, it started to feel a little bit slow. So I decided to install the iOS 12 beta, which I wouldn't advise doing unless you're using it on a secondary device or something.
The public beta just launched, I think. Didn't
so it,
it,
as it well? Is. So it
the oh, it's a public beta. Okay.
Yeah. So it's definitely better. I haven't personally experienced any crashes, but I definitely wouldn't turn around to someone and go like, oh yeah, definitely. But it's so fast. It's so much
really?
Appreciably faster. Really? It's little things like the keyboard. I was noticing the keyboard was popping up and like kind of crapping out a little bit previously. That doesn't really happen anymore. The Twitter app is a lot quicker. So, you know, if you've got an older Apple device and you're
like,
I don't want to upgrade, but I'm feeling like I have to because it's getting a bit slow, either wait for like the full release of iOS 12, which is probably going to happen around end of August, beginning of September, or if you're really desperate, try installing the iOS 12.
I mean, what phone does it support?
So it goes all the way back to the iPhone 6. S, I believe it might even be the iPhone 6.
Okay,
but it goes back a really long way. So especially if you're on an older device,
okay,
it's really good.
Really,
and like this is, I mean, people give me a lot of stick for still using the iPhone SE, but it does everything I need.
I think what's really interesting about it is maybe not that many people have older iPhones, but a lot of people have older iPads, so it'd be really interesting to see what it does to those as well, because certainly they get a bit sluggish after a few years.
Yeah, and that's the kind of thing you really don't want to upgrade, because it's not quite as sexy or as exciting. So that's my one cool thing this week. If you haven't checked out iOS 12, then maybe give it a look. Evan, though?
Well, I manically looked around for something, because I didn't know this was... and got this, which is IKEA's wireless speaker.
Cool.
We've been listening to it quite a lot in the office, actually, and it's... You know, it's pretty good. It only costs £45. I think there's an additional charge if you want the battery that comes with it. It's really cute because the handle, you have to connect it yourself.
And then that classic IKEA fashion.
It's IKEA, exactly. You get the little key.
So, how much does it cost? It's like, what?
Yeah, about £45, I believe. Yeah.
Which is really cheap for a Bluetooth speaker. They kind of happily go up into like 150, 200 quid.
They do. I mean, it's not that level of quality, but it's absolutely fine for most people. You know, it sounds easily as good as my Amazon Echo or something like that.
It's always like really impressive when IKEA start to go into these like niche little areas. Like, I know they've produced a bicycle in the past. They do like a little bit of like solar lighting and stuff, which is solar panels even.
Yeah.
And whenever they go into those areas, it's always interesting how they approach it. This one, it seems like, I mean, I'd imagine they've just taken off-the-shelf components from Chinese manufacturers and that sort of thing.
I'm sure. But you know, they also did the wireless charging tables as well, which are quite nice. You know, that's another really nice addition. If you've got a bit of a techie home and you've got a wireless charging phone, you know, it's great to have a table you can just rest it on.
Yeah, it's the table you probably would have bought anyway from IKEA. And,
exactly.
So are we going to get a full review on the site for that soon?
Yes, we will, yes.
Excellent. Cool. Well, thank you so much, guys, for joining us in this live stream of ReNews. If you're listening to this later, we are actually going to put this up on SoundCloud for you to listen to in a podcast format, so be sure to check that out and subscribe to us for more episodes, both on iTunes and also on YouTube. But until then, I've been John.
Bye.
See ya.